I greet the children of God in the mighty name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
We will go to the Word.
Luke chapter 24.
Luke 24.
Verse 49.
Verse 49.
Maybe we could start from verse 46. And get to
49.
You read it, Pastor.
He told them, "This is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I am going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high."
Amen. Our message will be, stay. Wait upon the Lord. Stay in the city. Wait upon the Lord. Jesus Christ's instructions to his disciples before his ascension were very clear. He says, wait in Jerusalem and expect power. There was no hint given about what would happen. But clearly, the evidence shows that Jesus knew what would occur. He says, the promise of my Father. Remember, Jesus Christ emphasized the fact that he is in the Father is in him. Because the Father makes himself known to us through Jesus. But you still had people who were always accompanying him, asking him to show them the Father. And he said to Philip, "I've been with you for so long, and yet you still want to see the Father. When you see me, you see the Father." But now here, he is assuring his disciples, in case they do not yet believe that the Father is in him. Now, if you don't believe what he does, he says, now I'm going to get the promise of the Father. The promise of the Father. He has given them commission. They need to go and witness. But he knows they are not ready. They are not yet fully equipped. They are not yet strong enough. They were tormented by the fact that they saw a lot of persecution. They saw him being pulled this way and that way. They saw the cross. They saw pain. They were tormented. And they were not bold enough. They cannot go out there into the cruel world that is waiting for them on their own, unless power from on high comes upon them and equips them. Jesus says, you will receive the power. Stay. Stay. They will receive the power if they obey and they stay. If they stay together. And the word of God says, they were in the upper room. Remember, they had seen him being transfigured. They saw him going into the cloud and disappearing. And they were tormented. Their hearts were painful. But he knew he had a way of comforting them. The Holy Spirit would come. The Holy Spirit would comfort them. The Holy Spirit would make them confident. The Holy Spirit would give them boldness. The Holy Spirit would rejuvenate them. The Holy Spirit would give them the zeal, the courage, the energy to go out and face anything, any form of persecution. They will go out and witness. They will take the word to the ends of the earth. But the Holy Spirit will also comfort them about the pain of the physical absence of Jesus. They saw their master leave, and that was not a nice thing for them. Now, they were filled with pain, but Jesus Him being God, he knew what he was doing. The Holy Spirit would come, and then Jesus Christ would multiply himself in every one of them. And Jesus would be able to communicate with anyone wherever they are, because then he would be in their hearts. Jesus Christ will be in their hearts. He will communicate with any one of them at any given moment. The Holy Spirit of God had to come. The promise of the Father had to come so that from that point people would understand the finished work of the cross. They would understand the finished work of the cross. Remember at the beginning, Peter did not understand that the Master had to die. He even wanted to say, no, you cannot go that way. But Jesus knew it was the Spirit behind him. He rebuked the spirit. Peter was confused and he was taking actions without the orders from the Master. When the people came looking for Jesus, he throws the sword and he cuts the ear of Malchus. And Jesus Christ says, hold it. Slow down. He takes the ear and puts it back. The same Peter, when the young servant lady comes and says, I think you were with them, he is the one who denies Jesus 3 times in the same night. But look at what happens. On the day of Pentecost, when the day of Pentecost had fully come, when the day of Pentecost had fully come, the same Peter is the one that stands up with boldness, because he had been equipped by the power from on high. When the people think they are drunk, he says, look at the time. It's only 9 o'clock in the morning. These people are not drunk. He preaches the word. He preaches Jesus, him crucified. He preaches the word, and 3,000 people come to accept Jesus Christ. Now Peter is bold. Now Peter is confident. Now Peter is organized. Now Peter follows guidance. Now Peter follows directions. Now he is guided by the Holy Spirit and he talks sense, and he knows now the way is clear before him. He sees the cross, he understands the cross, he understands the need that Jesus had to die so that you and I can be saved. Generations and generations, Peter understands now. All the disciples, they understand now. Wait in the city, wait in the tent of Solomon, until power from on high comes. 1 Corinthians 2:9.
However, as it is written, what no eye has seen, what no ear has heard, and what no human mind has conceived, the things God has prepared for those who love him.
Amen. This message, this scripture, you can interpret it in different ways. Maybe when you hear it, you listen to it from the first time, you would think something, there's something that God is still planning to bring to us. We had this message from MZ. We had this message from Pastor Lazarus. Hey, I'm here to tell you, I has not seen, ear has not heard. Now, the mind of God conceived things from before the foundations of the earth. These things are in the heart of God. He even planned, he put together a big plan of salvation. These things are in the heart of God. But they will only be revealed to the people who have the Spirit of God. Because the Holy Spirit that the Master promised, that he will lead us into all the truth, when he comes, he will lead those who have the Spirit of God into all the truth. But to those who don't have the Spirit of God, these things will sound foolish. But these things will be revealed. Now let me tell you tonight, these things are packaged. They are there already. They are there. God He's not going back to the drawing board. Nothing takes him by surprise. Everything that he intended for us is there. It is there. It is packaged. Now it is waiting for you and I to get ready, to be equipped, so that these things can be revealed to us. Because spirit speaks to spirit. Spirit speaks to spirit. Jesus Christ wants us to open our eyes. These things the word of God says, they have not even entered into the heart of man. But listen, Jesus Christ, the genius of Jesus Christ, the genius of God, he confounded the kingdom of darkness. He confounded the devil. They had no idea what he was up to. They had no idea what was going to happen. If they knew what was going to happen, they would not have killed him. And you and I would have not been saved. Jesus had to die. Jesus had to go to the cross. It was all a mystery hidden in the heart of God so that you and I can be saved. But this mystery would only be revealed when the Holy Spirit is in our midst, when the Holy Spirit moves and hovers over us, when the Holy Spirit clothes us with wisdom, with understanding, with understanding, with counsel, with revelation. Only then will we be able to figure out what is happening. Ear has not heard. Eye has not seen. Greater things are going to be revealed. He says to his disciples, I'm going to the Father. And you will do greater things. Because I'm going to the Father. You see, this condition is beautiful. If Jesus stays with them, they will not do greater things than the things he does. He has to leave. The heart had to be painful. They have to miss him. So that they can do greater things. So that the multiplication of Jesus will happen. So that every one of us will be the ambassador of the King of Kings. When you are an ambassador of the King of Kings, you have to adopt his character. You have to walk like him. You have to talk like him. You have to see like him. You have to look like him. So that when they come, the little girl would say, you look like them. You were with them. They should see the power inside you. Jesus Christ knew what he was doing. But listen, the day of Pentecost, it was a big day. And normally people who come from far, they would be wandering around going to see relatives and friends. But you have this bunch of 120 obedient and spiritually disciplined, who stayed together. They were not just staying together. They were in one accord. They were in agreement. Now listen to me. They had to wait 10 days before power from on high came. Why 10 days? Because they had to go through purification. They had to go through repentance. They had to identify their sin. They had to empty themselves from themselves. Because you see the problem. When we are full of ourselves, we are not able to obey, because obedience needs humility. Now, when you are full of yourself and you want to build a reputation and you want some kind of fame and you are full of yourself, you cannot go down. You cannot go down. Solomon was not stupid. He said to God, Father, I'm dedicating the temple to you. When your people come here, when the heavens are shut down, when there is famine and pestilence, please listen to their prayers and heal them. And God responded immediately in 7:14. If my people who are called by my name humble themselves and go down and identify their sins and they resolve to move away from their sins and they pray and seek my face, I'll hear their prayer from heaven. I will forgive their sins and I will heal the land. Humility. So the disciples had to wait 10 days. That was the period of purification. They had to repent. You see, Holy Spirit was busy revealing to them their own sins one by one. They had to deal with them and they had to go down and humble themselves and allow themselves to be sanctified, to be set apart for the work of God. Because unless you empty yourself completely, then the Holy Spirit cannot fill you. Because the Holy Spirit cannot fill you. We were told in the commandments, you have to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, with all your strength. Now, all your heart. So which means all your heart has to be in God. It has to occupy God. The whole space of the heart. I'm talking about the inner person. Don't reserve anything. Because if you reserve some space, it means there are some other little idols that you are also paying attention to. But if the whole heart is reserved for God, there's no space for any idol. There's no space for pride, for arrogance, for bitterness, for anger, for jealousy. There's no space. All the space that you have is the space for love, because God is love. Now, when you accommodate God in your heart, you accommodate the love of God. All you are going to do from there is to reflect the love of God, is to rise and shine, is to reflect the love of God, because all you are is the love of God. The word of God says, where your heart is, that's where your treasure is. If your heart is in God, that is where your treasure is. If your heart is in the word, that is where your treasure is. When you open your mouth, you will speak the language of heaven. You will speak fire. You will speak deliverance. You will speak hallelujah. You will speak amen. You will sing hosanna, because you are full of the word, because you are full of God, because your heart contains God. God only and nothing else. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's wave our hands. Let's wave our hands and worship this God. Let us empty ourselves of ourselves. Let's empty ourselves of ourselves. We were in the Father's meeting one day. And the man of God said, you know what, fathers, there's a life that you lived that you don't want your son to know. And it's about 80 to 90% of your life. It was a real bad life. And we all know it. And that part of life, we don't want it to be known to our children. When we call our sons and they come and sit down with us, we take the only 10% that we have, which is good, and we portray it to our children as if it is 100% of our lives. Hey, don't lie to yourself now. Don't hide the sins. Do you know that God can even forgive you for the sins that you don't remember? But we can go down on our knees when we empty ourselves. We can ask God and say, Father, reveal all the sins, even the ones that I have forgiven, even the ones that I have forgotten, so that I can confess, so that I can resolve now and identify them and move away from them so that you can forgive me. I want complete forgiveness, not 90%, not 80%, 100%. And our God is the God of glory, is the God of mercy. We were taught about the duty list of virtues. Yes, of virtues. Now, if we want the mercy of God, Righteousness has to be there. Because when the mercy comes and he does not find righteousness, mercy will leave. Now righteousness has to be there. So we have to go down and confess all our sins and get purified so that when we call God for mercy, when mercy comes, mercy will stay. So the 10 days of the disciples, they were purifying themselves so that when the Holy Spirit comes, the Holy Spirit will fill them. Because you know what I'm here to tell you? Children of God, God the Father, the God of mercy, the God of heaven, Jehovah Rapha, he is more than ready to fill every one of us with the Holy Spirit. He is ready to fill us with the Holy Spirit. More than some of us are ready to buy our children food. Do you hear what I'm saying? Sometimes when you have to buy your children something nice, you duck and dive. But God, he is willing, he is ready, he is itching, he is raring to go. He wants to fill every one of us with the Holy Spirit of God. Because he knows when we have the Holy Spirit of God, the Spirit of revelation, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of grace, then we will obey because we will have understanding. We will have understanding. The book of Proverbs says, 4:5-6. Get wisdom. Get understanding. Get these things. But in all your getting, get understanding. And Holy Spirit is the Spirit of understanding. Now when you understand, you move solidly. Because you are grounded. You know where you are. You know where you belong. You know your master. You know who you are in him. And you can listen to him. And you can obey the instructions. It doesn't matter who they come to you through. It doesn't matter if they come to me through her. Or if they come to me through her. But if it's the instruction of God, the discernment spirit that he has given me will tell me, hey, God is speaking here. You better move because God is speaking. You see, don't look at who is bringing the news. Because you'll take him and throw them in the dungeon. You'll throw the prophets of God into the dungeon. Don't look at their stature. Don't look at their physique. Don't look at their background or their financial status. Listen and discern the word of God that comes to you through his servant. Because when he chooses servant, he is got this thing. He does not look on the outside. He is not impressed with the outside appearance. He looks at the heart of the person. And he will say, this is the man who is after my own heart. They had to be purified. We stay. We must stay. While we are staying, growth will happen. If we wander around, you can be in the tent and still wander around. You can be in the tent and not wait upon the Lord. You must wait upon the Lord. What we mean here, the Lord is talking. Those who read us Isaiah 40:31.
But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint.
Amen. Those who wait upon the Lord will have their strength renewed. What will renew your strength is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Because you wait hoping, you wait expecting. The disciples were waiting, but they were expecting because the master said, I'm bringing the promise of the Father. They are waiting, but they are expecting. Their strength is renewed. That is why they remain in the upper room in one accord, in agreement, with one heart, because they know they are hoping, they are hopeful, and they are expecting their master to bring and to deliver the promise of the Father. So we need to wait upon the Lord. Somebody said in their simple language there that good things come to those who wait. But we know that those who wait upon the Lord, when you wait upon the Lord, you see, he's not slack in delivering his promises. As people describe slackness, he brings and delivers his promises always at the right time. Because God cannot be come on the wrong time. He is above the ordinary time that is governing you and me. He is operating outside that time. But his time is even better than this time. So when he knows it is the right time, he would bring and deliver. Wait upon the Lord. They waited. They waited. Acts chapter 1 verse
4.
And being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart. Hey, not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you have heard from me. Hey. This you are hearing from me. Jesus Christ of Nazareth. The Son of the living God. The only Son. The firstborn. The only Son. You are hearing this from him.
So
you cannot make a mistake. It is sure to happen. Because every word that proceeds from his mouth comes to pass. So they are there. Waiting with energy, with hope and expectation. And they know what the master has promised is just what the doctor has ordered. And it will come to pass. You have heard from me, and for John baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Not many days from now. Now, it is not for you to know the times or seasons which the Father has put in his own authority. You don't have to know that. Just be ready. Just wait and be ready. Just wait and purify yourself. Just wait and humble yourself. Just wait and empty yourself of yourself. Just wait for this God. He will come. He will deliver at the right time. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you shall be witness to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and to the ends of the earth. We also know the commission on Matthew 28, isn't it? When they were doubtful whether is he really the Son of God, and he saw what was going on through their mind, and he says, hey, Luna. Power and authority has been given to me. Now, go ye therefore. You and I, we must go and make disciples of the whole earth and baptize those who believe in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And this power that Jesus has will be with us when we mention the name of Jesus. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, every demon shall bow, every problem shall bow, every challenge shall bow, every hiccup shall bow, every blockage shall bow, every rope, every knot, every cage shall bow at the name of Jesus, because it is the name above all the names. It is the name above all the names. And this name went there because he demonstrated obedience and he obeyed the Father up to the point of death, even death on the cross. Jesus Christ of Nazareth, when we have him in us, we have everything. We have everything. Now, here, Acts chapter 1, verse 5. It is the empowering for ministry that was promised in Luke 24:49. Jesus knew These people had to take the word to the ends of the earth. But they cannot just go like that. They had to be empowered. They have to be empowered. When you have a group of researchers that you want to send out into the field, you have to train them and equip them and give them the scope on what they are going to research and what kind of questions they are going to ask and what kind of people they are going to talk to and what amount of time are you giving them and what is the minimum, the least of errors that you expect. Jesus wanted them to be equipped for the Great Commission because souls must come to Jesus. The big plan of salvation is that everybody must come on board. That is the duty for you and me. When we come into the tent of Salem, we are coming here to be equipped to be better people that can take the word with confidence, with conviction, with energy, with vigor, with understanding, and take it to the end of the earth, because we are supposed to represent Jesus Christ. But we depend on that power. Hey, Jesus himself, his life has been governed, has been from the beginning. His life was conceived by the Holy Spirit. His ministry was authorized by the Holy Spirit. The dove after baptism landed upon him. When the heavens opened and the Father said, "This is my Son, in whom I'm well pleased." The ministry starts there. And Jesus starts preaching. Luke 4:18. If you take it from Isaiah, Luke 4:18. Say, the Spirit has anointed me to proclaim this way, to go and release the bound. Jesus. He says, the Spirit is upon me. His ministry was authorized by the Holy Spirit. Now that is why he knows the importance of equipping the disciples before they go and take the way to the ends of the earth. They had to wait for the anointing, for the power, for the authority of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Are we still together? Are we happy to be here? Are we happy to belong together? Are we happy that I have someone next to me? Call him a sister or brother. Say, hey, brother, I'm happy to have you next to me. I know I have a sense of belonging. The brother I don't have out there is here in the tent of Salem. The sister I don't have out there is here in the tent of Salem. The mother I don't have out there is here in the tent of Salem. The father or the uncle or the cousin that I don't have out there is here in the tent of Salem. When you are here and you have Jesus, you have everything. But if you have the whole world and all the wealth, but you don't have Jesus, you have nothing. So we thank God for the tent of Salem. We are here. So for this commission, he had to prepare these people so that they can go out with conviction. All they needed was to be filled with the supernatural power by being baptized by the Holy Spirit. That's what they needed. That's what you and me need. We need to be empowered by the Holy Spirit. But let us help the cause. Let us obey. Let us go down and empty ourselves and confess our sins and ask for forgiveness. Let us take a resolution that we resolve that we are not going back to that sin. We give the sin our back. It becomes a very strange sin, a very strange thing. Sin must be strange and weird. It must not be part of our vocabulary. It must not be in our lexicon. So then the Holy Spirit will fill us, and the rest will be history. Jesus is a primary example of the work of the Holy Spirit within and upon us. Jesus' life was conceived by the Holy Spirit, and the Spirit working within him brought forth the fruit of good character. Read Luke 2:52.
And Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and men.
How? He grew in... Read it again, my pastor.
And Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and men.
All these things are on his side. He grew in wisdom and stature. So, when he comes, you don't have to ask who he was. You would know. And the most important thing, he found favor with God and favor with man. When you have favor with God, you will have favor with man. Now, this is the good fruit. This is the good character that comes out of Jesus because of the work of the Holy Spirit working within him. Jesus grew in wisdom and stature. That is what we need to be. Jesus Christ wants us to be like him. He says he will declare us as his brothers. He says we are gods when you go to John 10:35. He says we are gods. Jesus Christ says, how I desire in John 17:24, that you may be with me where I am, that you may behold the glory that my Father has given me. Jesus says to the Father, I'm praying for them. They might be in the world, but they are not of the world. But I am praying for them because they know that I have given them your word. I told them the word that I gave them is from you. And that is why he is praying for us. Jesus Christ wants us to be like him. So that we don't have to explain ourselves. When they find you sitting around the fire, they should just say, yeah, you were one of them. Without you having to explain yourself. So Jesus is the King of Kings. They returned to Jerusalem. And that is after he had left. They were depressed. They were not feeling very good. But very soon, comfort would be coming. There's something that I want to read for us. This is 1 Corinthians 2:9. But I'll read the notes that I put down here. Those who receive the doctrine of Christ as divine and having been enlightened by the Holy Spirit have looked well into it, they see not only the plain history of Christ and him crucified, but the deep and admirable designs of divine wisdom therein. It is the mystery made manifest to the saints. Let us read Colossians 1:26.
The mystery that has been kept hidden for ages and generations, but is now disclosed to the Lord's people.
The mystery that has been hidden for generations and ages, it is now being revealed to the children of God. So we are here. What an honor. Say, what an honor. To be in the house of God. To hear from the mouth of God. Let's give Jesus a hand of praise. You know, Elder Brian was here. And he said, he went to the scripture that talks about the children of Israel knowing the deeds of God. But Moses knowing God. Job says, I'm not talking about hearsay. I'm talking about, you know, I love that encounter with God. And here, we have that encounter with him. What an honor. What a privilege. What a favor. Let me tell you, children of God, I am here. This is my home. I love this home. I have a home. When the little children play in the street, when it gets dark, every one of them goes home. It's not a nice thing not to have a home. When the sun goes down, even the birds go to their nests. Everybody goes to their place. It's so beautiful that on these days, on Tuesdays, on Wednesdays, on Sundays, in fact, we are here, some of us, even on Thursdays, even on Monday, even on Saturday. And you know what? Have you seen this, the children of God? When you are here, and the woman of God comes here, and she closes with prayer, you don't go home. You don't go home. Why? This is our home. You just feel like you can lie here and be alone with your God. This is a good feeling when you have a sense of belonging. We belong here. This is the tent of Salem. This is where we hear God speak. This is where we commune with Him. This is where we fellowship with Him. This is where the angels minister to us. This is where we talk to the Holy Spirit. This is where we mix with heaven, because heaven is in touch with this place. This is where we celebrate life, because we appreciate God from this place. And He speaks to us from this place. And we get wisdom from this place. And we grow more and more in the knowledge of God from this place. What an honor. What a favor. Some people don't hear what we are hearing. I'm not laughing at them. I'm not looking down upon them. It is you and me's responsibility to make sure they hear what we are hearing. That is why Jesus Christ wants us to be fully equipped with the Holy Spirit when we come here. Anointing upon anointing. Purifications happen. And we must go there before, in front of the face of God with honesty and genuineness. You know, the honesty of a child. I have the favor of praying for the children on Sunday. They are honest. When they are happy, they laugh. And they are not pretending. When they are fed up, they cry. They are not pretending. When they love you, they run to you and hug you. They are not pretending. They are very honest. They are very genuine. They don't know how to pretend. But wait until they grow up. And you and I whisper things in their ears and start poisoning them, teaching them hatred, teaching them how to bear grudges, teaching them not to talk to this and that, teaching them how to be arrogant, how to be spoiled, how to be proud. Children are honest. We are children of God. We must be like those children when we come before the face of God. Jesus is the Lord of glory. There are many things which people would not do if they knew the wisdom of God in the great work of redemption. There are things God has prepared for those, listen, for those that love Him and wait. There are big things that God has prepared for those who love Him and wait. Great things are coming. Those great things are here. God is revealing them. The more we receive the Holy Spirit, the more we are filled with the Holy Spirit, is the more we will see. These things are here. Eye has not seen, ear has not heard. Even none of them has entered into the heart of man. But I'm telling you here in this tent, eyes will open. I'm not talking about physical eyes. I'm talking about the spiritual eyes. The eyes of the Spirit will open. The eyes of the Spirit will open. We cannot be beaten by demons. Demons and worshippers and devil worshippers, they see in the Spirit. We must also see in the Spirit. We are children of God. We have more power. Our God is miles and miles ahead of the devil. That's why he confounds him and even makes a spectacle of him. He goes down into the grave and he takes the keys. The key from hell and the key from death. And he abolishes death. That is our master. And the power that took him out of the grave is in me and you. That power is in me and you. We have the power. He even says with his own mouth, I give you power and authority to trample upon scorpions and snakes and all power of darkness, and nothing shall by any means harm you. Jesus Christ is talking. So we have the master on our side. We have a winning combination. There's no way that we cannot win. We thank the Lord. Ephesians 4:30.
And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption.
Don't grieve him. You make a mistake with Jesus, that sin could be pardoned. But with the Holy Spirit, it's another matter. Don't grieve him. You know what? When I express hatred towards my brother or my sister, I grieve the Holy Spirit. When I say something bad about my brother or my sister, I grieve the Holy Spirit. So let's not, you see, all of us, we always want to be in the presence of the Holy Spirit. David, after having committed sin with Bathsheba, he comes before God and he says, please, don't take your Holy Spirit away. Do not take your Holy Spirit away from me. We love the Holy Spirit. We must embrace the Holy Spirit. Say, I love the Holy Spirit. I embrace the Holy Spirit. I always want to be in the presence of the Holy Spirit. I want revelation. I want wisdom. I want counsel. I want comfort. I want understanding. I want peace. I want grace.